supraglottic, glottic, and subglottic.
Supraglottis, glottis, and the subglottis. Okay. What are the parts included in the supraglottis?
In supraglottis, hyoid one and thyrohyoid membrane.
Sound the.
In glottis, vocal.
Supraglottis only hyoid bone and thyrohyoid membrane.
Epiglottis also.
Yeah. Epiglottis. Any other parts?
Aryepiglottic fold.
Yeah, aryepiglottic fold. Then. Epiglottic folds, arytenoids, Chanakya. What is vestibule of the larynx?
Supraglottic part is known as
vestibule. What is your roll number?
Fifty-eight, sir.
Your name?
Deepika, sir.
Deepika. Okay. So you are answering by seeing the textbook or without seeing in the book?
Without seeing, sir.
Okay. So vestibule. What is vestibule? Not supraglottis, not entire supraglottis. Do you know what is laryngeal inlet?
Yes.
What is laryngeal inlet? Laryngeal inlet. Okay, where the larynx opens into the as a laryngeal cavity, so that is at the tip of the epiglottis, that is the laryngeal inlet. Okay, laryngeal inlet is formed by the epiglottis, aryepiglottic folds on either side, and posteriorly arytenoids. Okay, so the part of the larynx which is from the laryngeal inlet to the false vocal cords, okay, are vestibular folds. So that is the vestibule of the larynx. False vocal cords are vestibular folds. So the laryngeal cavity between the laryngeal inlet and up to the level of the false vocal cords only we call it as vestibule. Okay. 58, Deepika.
Sir.
So that is the vestibule, not entire the supraglottis. So you have to understand the difference between the vestibule and the supraglottis. Supraglottis means above the glottis, so above the true vocal cords. So supraglottis includes the vestibule and also ventricle. What is the ventricle of the larynx?
True vocal cords, sir.
Ventricle of the larynx.
Glottic part.
No, glottis means the space between the true vocal cords, that is the glottis. Okay, space between the true vocal cords, that is the glottis or rima glottidis. But ventricle is the space between the false vocal cords and the true vocal cords. Okay, that is the ventricle of the larynx.
Sir, then what is rima glottis?
Rima glottis and glottis both are same. Rima glottidis or glottis. Okay. Rima glottidis or glottis both are same. That is the space between the true vocal cords. When the vocal cords are in abducted position, there is a space. That is the rima glottidis. Or glottis. So glottis includes the only entire vocal cords from anterior commissure to the posterior commissure. Okay. Both the vocal cords unite anteriorly and they form the ligament that is the Broyles ligament that is attached to the inner surface of the thyroid cartilage. Just below the thyroid nerves, there is attachment of these true vocal cords. So that means supraglottis includes both the vestibule and the ventricle of the larynx. From the laryngeal inlet to the false vocal cords is the vestibule. Between the false vocal cords and the true vocal cords is the ventricle. So combinedly, these two are comes under the supraglottis only. These two are present above the true vocal cords. So subglottis is just below the or under surface of the vocal cords to the lower border of the cricoid cartilage. That is the subglottis. Okay. So the parts which comes under the supraglottis are the epiglottis, aryepiglottic folds, arytenoids, and the false vocal cords. So these are the parts which comes under the supraglottis. Chanakya. So today's topic is congenital lesions or congenital abnormalities of the larynx. So before that, little bit about the development of the larynx, how the larynx will develop. So development of the larynx occurs during the fourth week of intrauterine life. So at the fourth week only, development of the larynx will start. So this is the foramen cecum and this is the hypobronchial eminence. These are the branchial arches, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the 6. Fifth will disappear. So this is the laryngotracheal groove, and this is the fourth branchial arch. Hypobranchial eminence and foramen cecum. So the larynx begins as a slit-like diverticulum. So that is the laryngotracheal groove in the ventral wall of a pharynx. So this is in the fourth week of intrauterine life. So there is a slit-like opening in the ventral wall of the pharyngeal wall. So that is the larynx begins as a development in the fourth week itself. Fourth week of intrauterine life. So the groove gradually deepens and it adjusts fused to form the septum. So these two edges will form the septum. That septum will separates the pharynx and the esophagus posteriorly from the larynx. So this septum separates the laryngotracheal tube from the pharynx and esophagus. So this groove will become a septum. This septum will separate the pharynx and the esophagus posteriorly. This is our dorsally, this is the ventral laryngotracheal groove. Between 5th and 6th week of intrauterine life, there is appearance of the three swellings. So one is in the center, two on the other side. The center swelling, we call it as hypobranchial eminence. So that is derived from the fourth branchial arch. So this is the hypobranchial eminence in the center. This is the epiglottic swelling. This is the laryngeal inlet. And these two are the arytenoid swellings. Hypobranchial eminence, arytenoid swellings in the 5th and 6th week of intrauterine life. So two lateral arytenoids, one in the center, that is the hypobranchial eminence. So two lateral swellings derived from the 6th branchial arch moves medially and form a T-shaped aperture. Here you can see the these two lateral arytenoid swellings moves medially and it forms a T-shaped aperture, that is the laryngeal inlet. So from the hypobronchial eminence there is development of the epiglottis. Hypobronchial eminence, epiglottis. These two lateral arytenoid swellings will give the development of the rest of the larynx. So laryngeal lumen temporarily occluded at the 8th week of intrauterine life. By the 10th week of gestation, there is recanalization occurs. So, as a result of here in 8th week, there is a proliferation of the epithelial cells that will occlude the lumen of the larynx temporarily for the 2 weeks, about 8th to 10th week. So by the 10th week of gestation, recanalization of this laryngeal cavity occurs and consequently pair of laryngeal ventricles are formed. So the laryngeal ventricles are bound by mesenchyme tissue that condense and progress to form the false and true vocal cords. So laryngeal cartilages develop from the mesenchyme of the bronchial arches, both 4th and 6th bronchial arches. The cartilages are the mesodermal developments. So thyroid cartilage from the fourth arch mesenchyme has two lateral plates. They meet in the midline. Arytenoid, corniculate, cricoid cartilage and the fecal cartilage from the sixth branchial arch and epiglottis from the hypobranchial eminence. Intrinsic laryngeal muscles develop from the mesoderma, both fourth and sixth branchial arches. This is about the development of the larynx. So then coming to the epidemiology of these congenital laryngeal lesions or congenital laryngeal abnormalities. So there is some developmental problem then that leads to these kind of problems or abnormalities. So 80 to 85% of children less than 3 years of age with stridor have a congenital etiology for stridor. So that means there is some problem in the larynx or trachea or a tracheobronchial tree, then they develop the stridor. If the child is present within 3 years with history of stridor, so then you should think of some congenital problem in the larynx, either larynx or tracheobronchial tree, up to 80 to 85% of the children. What is stridor? Deepika, roll number 58. Stridor, do you have any idea?
Abnormal respiratory sounds.
Abnormal?
Respiratory sound.
Sound. Why will get you this abnormal respiratory sound? What is the reason?
Any obstruction in the supraglottic area?
Yeah, anywhere in the supraglottis, glottis, or nasopharynx, or subglottis, or trachea, or tracheobronchial tree, then we'll get this stridor. Okay, so stridor is noisy respiration produced due to the turbulent of airflow. Okay, if there is any narrow in the air passage from the larynx and tracheobronchial tree, so then there is a turbulence of airflow through this narrowed air passage that leads to the noisy respiration. So this noisy respiration may be during the inspiration or expiration or both the times, during inspiration and the expiration, then we'll get this stridor. So children with less than 3 years of age, just a minute. Hello, students.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this stridor may be due to problem in the larynx or trachea or tracheobronchial tree. So definition for stridor is noisy respiration due to the turbulent of air flow through narrowed air passages. Noisy respiration due to the turbulence of air flow through narrowed air passages. That is the definition for stridor. So if the children are present within 3 years of life with this stridor, then you should suspect some congenital abnormality in around 80 to 85% of the children. So 60% of these anomalies are larynx, in the larynx. So rest of the 40% may be in the trachea or tracheobronchial tree. 20 to 25% of anomalies are of trachea and the bronchial, both. 45% patients have more than one anomalies. So in 100 people, in 45% there is more than one anomaly in the these congenital abnormalities. So these abnormalities, laryngeal abnormalities, may be supraglottis, glottis, or subglottis. So in supraglottis, there is a laryngomalacia, supraglottic web, saccular cyst, congenital laryngocele, and supraglottic cleft. So cleft is nothing but opening in the supraglottic part, and it will communicate into the esophagus. So laryngocele is a cyst formation in the supraglottic region. And saccular cyst also is a cystic swelling in the supraglottis. And web is a fibrous adhesion formation between the both the sides of the larynx. And laryngomalacia. Glottis, in glottic abnormalities, vocal cord paralysis. So there is no movement, movements of the vocal cords, maybe unilateral or bilateral. Glottic web, glottic stenosis, and Kreidou-Chart syndrome. So that is genetic abnormality. In subglottis, subglottic stenosis, subglottic web, and the subglottic hemangioma or the lymphangioma. Subglottic hemangioma or the lymphangioma. So these are the abnormalities in the larynx, congenital abnormalities, supraglottis, glottis, and subglottis. Supraglottis mainly laryngomalacia. So it is the one of the commonest congenital abnormality of the larynx. We'll discuss in detail about the laryngomalacia. Common congenital abnormalities, laryngomalacia accounts for the 60%, vocal cord paralysis for 20%, subglottic stenosis for 15%, and subglottic hemangioma for the 1.5%. So coming to the supraglottic abnormalities, so in this, as I told, laryngomalacia or congenital laryngeal stridor. Laryngomalacia, the other name for the laryngomalacia is the congenital laryngeal stridor. So this is the commonest abnormality of the larynx, congenital abnormality. So the exact etiology for the development of this laryngomalacia is not known, but the proposed theories for the this laryngomalacia is the mal development of the cartilaginous structures in the supraglottic region, and there is a gastroesophageal reflex disease and immaturity of the neuromuscular control. So there is excess flaccid cartilages. So as compared to the adults, the cartilages are the very soft and pliable in the pediatric age group. But in these people, more pliable and the more soft, and there is a collapsibility of these supraglottic structures during the inspiration. Because of the negative pressure during the inspiration, all the supraglottic structures will collapse and completely occlude the lumen of the larynx. Then child will get the stridor. So, and it is characterized by excessive flaccidity of the supraglottic larynx, which is sucked in during the inspiration, producing the stridor, and sometimes cyanosis. So mostly, most of these people will have the only stridor. So these symptoms will appear around a few weeks after the birth, and they will progress up to the 1 year of age, and gradually they will resolve by the age of the 2 years. So the patient will have the mainly inspiratory stridor. So this stridor will increase on supine position and during the feeding, and also during the respiratory infections, and also during the exertion or crying. So these are the four aggravating factors for the inspiratory stridor in the laryngomalacia: supine position, feeding, respiratory infection, and the exertion. And it is relieved by the neck extension and the prone position. So the main prominent symptom is a inspiratory stridor because of the collapsibility or flaccidity of the supraglottic structures. Phonation or cry is normal. So cry is normal in these children. So if they cry, you will get the normal cry sound. Because these abnormality is involving the supraglottic structures only. The two vocal cords are completely normal, but that's why they'll have the normal cry. Feeding difficulties and failure to thrive, dyspnea, and the cyanosis are very rare in this laryngomalacia. So how will you confirm the diagnosis? It is a clinical diagnosis, and in severe cases you can see the intercostal retractions, intercostal spaces retractions into the chest. So that is because of the stridor and the negative pressure, there is a retractions. So to confirm the diagnosis, we need to examine the larynx by using the flexible laryngoscopy, rigid laryngoscopy or flexible laryngoscopy or direct laryngoscopy under general anesthesia. You need to examine all the laryngeal structures. So on flexible laryngoscopy, you can see the elongated and longitudinal folding of the epiglottis, that is called the omega shaped epiglottis. So that falls posterior-inferiorly on inspiration. So there is a redundant bulky arytenoids prolapse anteriorly and medially on inspiration. Arytenoids are present posteriorly, so that there is a prolapse and the medial falling of these arytenoids. Shortening and the medial collapse of the epiglottic folds. So these are the three things you can observe in the flexible laryngoscopy. There is a elongated and folded omega shaped epiglottis, redundant bulky arytenoids, prolapse anteriorly and medially on inspiration, and shortened and medially collapsible aryepiglottic folds. So aryepiglottic folds, arytenoids, and the epiglottis, all the supraglottic structures will have the abnormality. So once there is expiration, during expiration results in expulsion of these structures with free airflow. So that's why they doesn't have the expiratory stridor, only inspiratory stridor, because of the collapsibility of these supraglottic structures. So like this, you will see in the flexible laryngoscopy epiglottis. So omega shaped epiglottis, there is a elongated and the curved epiglottis, that is the omega shaped epiglottis. You cannot see the clearly the anterior part of the vocal cords in the sometimes if it is very severe, you can't see the posterior part of the glottis also. So these are the clinical pictures. You can see in normal people, if you do the flexible video laryngoscopy or rigid video laryngoscopy, you see the epiglottis, anterior commissure, true vocal cords, arytenoids, aryepiglottic folds, and glottic space. So in between the true vocal cords, you'll see the glottic space. This is the indirect laryngoscopy picture. These are the laryngomalacia or congenital laryngeal stridor pictures. So here on inspiration, see the collapsibility of this entire supraglottis, that is the epiglottis folded on itself. There is an omega shaped epiglottis. There is no space for the breathing at all. And there is here you can observe the arytenoids. So bulky arytenoids collapse into anteriorly, there is a collapsibility. And this is the aryepiglottic fold, very short aryepiglottic folds. So between the arytenoid cartilage and the epiglottis, posterior border of the epiglottis, there is an aryepiglottic fold. So very shortened aryepiglottic folds, redundant bulky arytenoids, and these arytenoids will prolapse into anteriorly, and these aryepiglottic folds prolapse into the medially. And there is a curved epiglottis and omega-shaped epiglottis, so that we can't see the clearly the vocal cords and the subglottic structures in the laryngomalacia. So if you want to examine and rule out the other any abnormalities in the larynx, like in the glottis and the subglottis, we need to do the rigid bronchoscopy under general anesthesia, so that you can pass the scope. So with the flexible scope, because of the collapsibility of these structures, we can't see the glottis and the subglottic structures clearly. So treatment, most of these cases will resolve spontaneously by the age of the 2 years. These cartilages will become the stiff by increasing the age, so that there is no collapsibility of the supraglottic structures. So if there is any gastroesophageal reflex disease is there, you need to treat the that disease. So rarely in 1% of cases we may require the surgical treatment, that is the tracheostomy or epiglottoplasty or repair of the epiglottic structures. So if you do the tracheostomy, you need to keep the tracheostomy tube for the till the age of the 2 years. So by that age, the laryngeal cartilages, the proglottic laryngeal cartilages will become the stiff and there is no collapsibility. So if it is a severe case, then we need to remove the part of the epiglottis on either side. So that is called the epiglottoplasty by using the cautery or the laser assisted epiglottoplasty. So in normal people, during the inspiration, there will be an adequate space. But in case of this laryngeal malacia, because of the collapsibility, there is a narrow space. So other supraglottic abnormality is the congenital laryngoceal. Congenital laryngoceal. These laryngoceals may be seen in the acquired cases also. Dilatation of the laryngeal saccule and extends between the thyroid cartilage and the ventricle, that is the laryngoceal. So when saccule is nothing but a blind sac which opens into the ventricle of the larynx. So ventricle, already I told, space between the false vocal cords and the true vocal cords. So it is a saccule, is a blind sac that opens into the ventricle, and it is present between the thyroid cartilage laterally and the false vocal cords and the epiglottic poles medially. So if it is distended, then we call it as laryngoceal. So it is air-filled dilatation of the ventricular sinus of the Morgagni. Clinical features are hoarseness or respiratory distress and neck swelling, and it is increased on the Valsalva maneuver. So Valsalva maneuver is nothing but asking the patient to close the nose and mouth and blow the air, so that there is a increase in the transglottic pressure, and then there is a dilatation of the increase in size of the laryngoceal. So investigations to confirm the laryngoceal are the plain X-ray of the soft tissues of the neck or flexible laryngoscopy like laryngeal malacia. Treatment is endoscopic marsupialization and the external excision by the thyroidectomy. So this is the external laryngoceal. Laryngoceals are the three types, internal, external and the combined or mixed. So this is the external variety. You can see the swelling outside the neck. So internal, external and the combined. Internal, we will see the 20% of people, only external 30%, in 50% both internal and external. So this internal, external, nothing but if the saccule or laryngoceal is confined to the only larynx without piercing the thyrohyoid membrane and without any external neck swelling, that is the internal. So if it is piercing the thyrohyoid membrane and it appears as a in the neck and the lateral neck swelling, cystic swelling, that is the external. So if it is present both in within the larynx and outside the larynx, that is the combined variety, 30, 20 and the 50%. And this is the X-ray neck AP view. You can see the air-filled cystic swelling on the lateral side of the neck. That is the laryngoceal. So one more is the treatment for the laryngoceal is excision and marsupialization of the laryngoceal. Complete excision by using the laser or by the marsupialization. Congenital laryngeal cyst. Next abnormality is the supraglottis congenital laryngeal cyst. So these are arising from the aryepiglottic poles and appears as a bluish fluid filled smooth swelling in the supraglottic larynx. So 40% congenital cyst found within hours of the birth. 95% of infants have the symptoms within 6 months. Features of the inspiratory stridor, improves on extension of the head. Cyanosis, feeding problems and failure to thrive will be there in these cases depending upon the size of the cyst. If it is very large, they'll have the more symptoms. So the main symptom is the stridor, inspiratory stridor, because of the mass effect within the laryngeal cavity. So treatment is, if the symptoms are very severe, immediately we should go for the tracheostomy. Endoscopic marsupialization of this cystic swelling in the aryepiglottic pole by using the laser or pole knife. Endoscopic incision and drainage of the cyst and total excision by using the endoscope or laryngofissure operation. Laryngofissure operation is nothing but opening the cricoid cartilage in the anterior part of the neck by giving the incision, that is the laryngofissure operation, and approaching the lesions of the larynx. So here you can see the cystic swelling in the aryepiglottic pole. This is the saccular cyst. So usually it is arising from the this mucus secreting glands. Obstruction to the mucus secreting glands leads to the formation of this swelling, saccular cyst. Laryngocele is different, laryngeal saccular cyst is different. So then coming to the glottic abnormalities. So the abnormalities within the glottis, that is in between the two vocal cords, or the only the vocal cords. So among these, congenital vocal cord paralysis. So the etiology for the congenital vocal cord paralysis, most of the time it is due to the birth trauma. So third one is the birth trauma. So during the breech presentation or forceps delivery, there is a damage to the vagus nerve or the recurrent laryngeal nerve, then you will see the vocal cord paralysis. Idiopathic and CNS lesions, if there is any intracranial abnormalities like corneal chiari malformation, cerebral palsy, hydrocephalus, myelomeningocele, spina bifida, the hypoxia. During the birth, there is any hypoxia. Sometimes rarely any mediastinal lesions, congenital lesions will cause the pressure over the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Then they'll have the vocal cord paralysis. Tumors or vascular malformations within the mediastinum also leads to this vocal cord paralysis. So unilateral vocal cord paralysis or bilateral vocal cord paralysis, most of the time it is unilateral, four times more common compared to the bilateral vocal cord paralysis. The children with the unilateral vocal cord paralysis, they'll have the hoarse and breathy cry aggravated by the agitation. So that breathy cry will increase during the agitation, means cry. If they have the cry, so a hoarse and breathy cry will aggravated by the agitation. Feeding difficulties and aspiration you will see in the bilateral vocal cord paralysis. So the if it is bilateral vocal cord paralysis, both the vocal cords are in the adducted position or paramedian position, just lateral to the median position. They'll have the strider, biphasic strider. So if the problems are in the supraglottic region, we'll see the only inspiratory strider. Glottis and the subglottis, we'll see the both inspiratory and expiratory strider. If the problem in the trachea and the tracheobronchial tree, we'll see the expiratory strider. So here there is a problem in the glottic region, that's why we'll see the both inspiratory and the expiratory strider, that is the biphasic strider and dysphonia. So that means there is no sound during the cry. So that is because of the vocal cord paralysis, bilateral vocal cord paralysis. They will not unite in the midline. That's why we won't get any sound from the vocal cords in bilateral vocal cord paralysis. So diagnosis same by using the flexible laryngoscopy or rigid bronchoscopy under general anesthesia. Treatment for the bilateral paralysis, vocal cord lateralization. We need to lateralize the vocal cord, or cordectomy, that means removal of the part of the vocal cord. Cordotomy is partial and cordectomy is complete removal of the entire vocal cord. Subtotal arytenoidectomy, so removal of the part of the posterior part of the glottis, to get the space in the posterior part of the glottis, will remove the medial part of the arytenoid cortex and the tracheostomy. So unilateral paralysis, you can wait because they'll have the only weak cry and without any aspiration problems or respiratory difficulty or apnea. So you can wait for at least 6 months. Most of the cases will resolve within 6 months in unilateral paralysis. So these are the surgical treatments, surgical procedures for the bilateral vocal cord paralysis. So here you can observe in this picture, there is lateralization of the vocal cord. So this is the vocal cord and vocal cord. This side, there is lateralization. So we need to make an opening in the thyroid cartilage and lateralize this vocal cord. So that we'll get the space for the breathing in the bilateral vocal cord paralysis. So this is cordectomy, removal of the entire vocal cord on one side. So these people will have the harsh voice. Both cordectomy and the lateralization, removal of the cord and also as well as lateralization of the cord, so that they will get the more space for the breathing. So second abnormality in the glottis is glottic web. So it occurs due to the incomplete recanalization of the larynx. So as I told, in the 8th week of embryonic life, there is an epithelial proliferation and the occlusion of the lumen of the larynx. And 8th to 10th week of intrauterine life, there is a recanalization of the larynx. So if there is any problem during the recanalization, this will occur. This is the glottic web. So that it occurs due to the incomplete recanalization of the larynx. It is mostly seen between the true vocal cords. That web seen is between the true vocal cords. So the here there is involvement of the true vocal cords. That's why they'll have the weak cry and the aphonia, hoarseness, inspiratory stridor in severe cases, and dyspnea on the exertion. So indirect laryngoscopy or flexible laryngoscopy, you can see the clear web between the, mostly you'll see the in the anterior commissure region, white or pink, thick or thin membrane that is attached to the anterior to the both vocal cords with sharp and curved posterior border. So like this, we'll see the web, glottic web. So here, this is the glottic web. There is a posterior border, pre-border. This is the space for the breathing. This is the anterior commissure. So in between the two vocal cords, there is a web. So that is the glottic web. Depending upon the size and the symptoms, we need to go for the treatment of the, this glottic web. So endoscopic division of this web by using the knife or laser and insertion of the, this laryngeal keel. So after incision, we need to keep the, this web apart. Otherwise, there is again readhesion between the, these membranous parts of the larynx. So that is the glottic web. To prevent the glottic web, we need to place the keel. So we need to divide the, this web by using the knife or laser. So glottic stenosis, if stenosis of the glottic area, which is present by the presented by the features of airway obstruction, that means stridor. So treatment is endoscopic division with knife or laser, insertion of the same keel. So Friedreich-Schwarz syndrome, so it is a genetic abnormality, partial depression of the short arm of the chromosome 5, high-pitched moving stridor. So that is, tri is like a cat. So that's why this is called the Friedreich-Schwarz syndrome. There is a diamond-shaped glottic space on examination, narrow vocal cords, curved elongated supraglottis. Treatment is supportive care and the genetic counseling if the symptoms are very mild. Subglottic abnormalities, congenital subglottic stenosis. So subglottis is the narrowest space in the pediatric age group, but in adults, the narrowest space is the glottis. So definition, when do you call it is a subglottic stenosis? If the diameter of the subglottic lumen is less than 4 millimeters in the term infant or less than 3 millimeters in the preterm infant, then we call it as, that is a subglottic stenosis. So at least it should be more than 4.5 to 5.5 millimeters, in between the 4.5 to 5.5 millimeters in the term infant. So that is the normal diameter of subglottic region. If it is less than 4 mm in the term infant and less than 3 millimeters in the preterm baby, then we call it as it is a congenital subglottic stenosis. So again, the etiology for this stenosis is incomplete recanalization and during the third month of gestation, incomplete recanalization of the laryngotracheal tube during the third month of gestation, that is the 10th week of gestation. So types may be membranous or cartilaginous. Membranous is more common and mild form. Cartilaginous is the less common and the severe form. So because of thickening of the cartilage, also will get this cricoid cartilage, also will get this subglottic stenosis. Most of the time it is membranous, more common, and it is milder variety. Clinical presentation is stridor. Symptoms appears in the first few months of life, biphasic stridor, and cry is normal because vocal cords will be normal. So it is diagnosed by the bronchoscopy. Most cases results spontaneously by 4 years of age because as the age progresses, there is an increase in space of the subglottic space. So tracheostomy and endotracheal tube intubation for significant stridor. So first we need to do the tracheostomy and endotracheal tube insertion if there is a severe stridor. Tube removed by the 4 years of age as the subglottic space widens. Laser ablation for membranous stenosis, if only small membrane is there, that is less than 5 mm, you can ablate the that membrane by using the laser. So in severe cases, so we need to go for the cricotracheal resection, laryngotracheoplasty in patients who could not decannulate. Decannulate means we are unable to remove this endotracheal tube. After 4 years also, if we remove that tube, tracheostomy tube or endotracheal tube, after 4 years also, if they still they have any breathing issues like stridor or breathing difficulty, then we need to go for the plasty, that is repair of the cricoid cartilage by using the prosthesis. So this is the grading for the subglottic region. If the lumen is in diameter of the lumen is between the 0 to 50%, that is the grade 1, 51 to 70%, that is the grade 2, in grade 3, 71 to 99%, that is the grade 3, and grade 4, complete closure, complete stenosis of the this subglottic region. Here you can see the subglottic web. This is a web. There is a partial opening posteriorly. Subglottic stenosis or subglottic web. So this is a baby with the tracheostomy tube. So for any stridor, immediately we need to do the tracheostomy. Then we'll place this tracheostomy tube. They will take the breathing through this tracheostomy tube, not through the nose, nostrils. So because it will bypass this airway, and directly they will take the inspiration and expiration through this tracheostomy tube. So in severe cases, we need to go for this cricoid cartilage split, and that is the laryngeal fissure operation. Then we need to place this yellow one in the rib cartilage. We need to harvest the rib cartilage and place between the both the sides of this cricoid arch. So that is the laryngotracheoplasty. So one more abnormality in the subglottic region is the subglottic hemangioma, congenital abnormalities. So it present asymptomatic till at the age of the 3 to 6 months, and the symptoms appears around the 3 to or after the 6 months of the age with increase in its size. So if the hemangioma size is increasing, then it will get the child will get the symptoms. So appears by the age of the 2 to 12 months. Biphasic stridor, again because it is subglottic region, barking cough, dyspnea, cyanosis, and retraction of the intercostal spaces, and the normal cry. So you need to remember, whenever the structures which are involved by the supraglottis or subglottis without involving the glottic region, the children will have the normal cry because the true vocal cords are normal. Once there is involvement of the glottis, then only there is a abnormal cry or hoarse cry and aphonia, we will see the in glottic abnormalities. Agitation of the patient or cry may increase airway obstruction due to the venous filling because it is a vascular mass hemangioma. So if they cry or there is increased venous filling into this venous this vascular structure, then the size of the mass will increase, and again they will get a more stridor. So 50% of these children will have the associated cutaneous hemangiomas in the head and neck region. The subglottic hemangioma children will have the associated cutaneous hemangiomas in the head and neck region in around 50%. Flexible laryngoscopy. If you do the laryngoscopy in subglottic region, you can see the unilateral or bilateral lesion, that is the hemangiomas. So located posterolateral in the subglottic mucosa, pink or pinkish to bluish in color, sessile and easily compressible. So this is the flexible laryngoscopy picture. So these are the vocal cords. This is the anterior commissure vocal cords, right vocal cord, left vocal cord. These are the hemangioma. Posterior laterally, there is a hemangioma that is causing the narrowing in the lumen of the subglottic region. Here also there is a hemangioma on the one side, unilateral or bilateral. Mostly it is posterior lateral. So this is again one more picture. Posteriorly there is a hemangioma bulge into the subglottic region. So management for small lesions you can observe without any treatment. For severe stridor cases, immediately you need to go for the tracheostomy, and tracheostomy tube kept till at the age of the 5 years. There is a majority of cases there is a spontaneous resolution of these hemangiomas by the age of the 5 years. That's why you need to keep the tracheostomy tube till that age. specific treatment for the this hemangioma, CO2 laser ablation, cryosurgery, intralesional injection of this sclerosing agents so that there is decrease in size of the hemangiomas, and open surgical excision. These are the various treatment options for the hemangioma, subglottic hemangioma. Subglottic web, it is due to the incomplete recanalization of the larynx again. Presenting features of the airway obstruction, weak cry, and the aphonia. So it can be, treatment is like a glottic web. You can cut the web by using the CO2 laser or pole knife. Silicon keel we need to keep in place after doing the surgery to maintain the lumen of the subglottic region. So that is about the congenital abnormalities or congenital